Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to greet you here in Bremen, even though I'm going to talk about a completely different subject, which is so far is not relevant to your everyday work. So today, I'm going to talk about Orbitrap mass spectrometry. And of course, we should remember that the heart of any mass spectrometer is, of course, mass analyzer. It's only part of the whole mass spectrometer, but in the end, it determines and defines analytical parameters which we are able to achieve with the whole instrument. And the main fundamental parameter, especially important for your work, is resolving power. And resolving power, when it is high enough, allows us to get much higher selectivity. And if we combine high resolving power with accurate mass, we could get accurate identification. Until Orbitrap entered the stage, only small mountain roads led to the land of ultra-high resolution. But with the introduction of Orbitrap, both highway and railway were brought into this land. And now ultra-high resolution is routine, at least in life science mass spectrometry. So today, I would like to start from replaying the history of this analyzer, how it all happened. And for this, we have to go a long way ago when I was still a student in Moscow Physics Engineering Institute. And I wanted to do something nice, something important. And so I started to play with the idea of developing an ideal mass analyzer. And of course, first ideal mass analyzer, as it looked to me, was FTICR. With huge magnet, it nevertheless offered extremely high resolving power, very high mass accuracy, sensitivity. Everything looked so nice except the magnet. And this is why I started to ask colleagues from FTICR group, why can't we trap ions without this big magnet, just in electrostatic field? And of course, they were much more experienced than me, and they told me that I should have learned my physics course better, that actually you cannot rest ions in electrostatic fields like they rest in FTICR cell. And of course, in my physics course, I learned Earnshaw's theorem, which states that charges cannot be maintained in a stable stationary equilibrium just by electrostatic interaction. So at the first glance, it looks like there is no chance, but then very soon I have learned the critical keywords in both of those statements, rest and stationary. If you take away these requirements that ions need to stay put in place, if they're moving, then they could be made stable in the same way as Sputnik is made stable in its orbit around the Earth. So this was quite a revelation. And then, as usual, I have found that this was known for many, many decades since 1923, when Kingdon introduced his orbital trap. And at that time, papers were like one page long with one experimental point. And his apparatus was equally simple. It was just a charged wire surrounded by this grounded can. And somehow with discharge, he was able to create ions which had tangential velocity inside this can. And if they had sufficiently high tangential velocity, they were not hitting central electrode, but rather rotating around this electrode. So in fact, yes, you could trap moving ions in electrostatic fields alone. However, there was no way to inject ions from outside into this field or to detect them. And even if somehow you could solve both of those tasks, there is no way you could get high performance in this system. So it didn't look like there is any promise. So I moved on and started to work on time-of-flight analyzers, where I first stumbled on this complicated quadrilogarithmic potential, which later became the basis for the Orbitrap analyzer. And at that time, it was realized with the dust particle impact ion source. And you could see here the first spectrum. These are isotopes of copper. So this is not exactly high resolution, but at least you could make this field part of an analytical device. And here you could see me, at that time, still a student without a beard, and with this analyzer, which my mother has called a mosquito catcher. So this was nice encouragement. And so I have moved on, and these were turbulent times, walls and empires crumbling and falling down, families and nations torn apart, but I was still busy designing different types of time-of-flight instruments. However, I had to make a decision, and I decided to stay on the path of high tech, and this forced me to go abroad. So I went to the UK, where I became consultant for Shimadzu Craters, and then this is where I met people with whom I started to work afterwards in a small high-tech startup, HD Technologies. And this company started in a cellar of a private house, and the director of the company, Steve Davis, stated the task for me in the following way. In order for our little company to succeed, we need to build something really new in a garage, in this case, in a cellar. And it would be nice to combine this super high resolution of FTICR, sensitivity of linear time of flight, with size and capabilities of a quadrupole ion trap. So this was a nice task, obviously not possible, but at least it was formulated in a way that would be understandable for a physicist. And actually, this is what happened in the end. Because if you look now at all different mass analyzers which we have in mass spectrometry, we have these major types, magnetic sector, quadrupoles, FTICR, ion traps, and time of flight. So if we talk about instruments which provide panoramic mass spectrum, then we have only three left, FTICR, ion traps, and time of flight. And each of them is characterized by its own set of features, like genome for biological things, and here we could call it instrumentome. For example, for FTICR, we have very high resolving power, mass accuracy, dynamic range, but not so good transmission, low speed, and simplicity is really bad. It's really complex. For time-of-flight instruments, we could have very good speed, dynamic range, mass accuracy, detection of all ions simultaneously. Resolving power nowadays is also quite reasonable, but transmission is very low, usually less than 1% or just few percents. And simplicity is also not as good. For ion traps, we have very high transmission, very simple device, detection of all ions, but mass accuracy is really bad. And resolving power is also usually not so good. And quantitation capabilities, not great. And therefore, if you try to introduce new analyzer, it should take the best features from all of those instruments. And this is why from ion traps, we took trapping in shaped in the fields created by shaped electrodes. From FTICR, we took image current detection. And from time of flight, pulsed injection into into electrostatic fields. And what we got in the end was all this history coming back in the different combinations. So if we combined orbital traps from Kingdom with this quadrilogarithmic potential, then we could create this field not by those multiple electrodes like I did in my experiments, but just by two equipotential surfaces, where we have a spindle on the axis and hyperconical electrodes on the outside. And between them, they define empty volume. And this is where we could trap those ions exactly like they were trapped in the Kingdon trap. And now, imagine that somehow we were able to create ion inside this volume with correct tangential velocity. In Kingdon trap, it moves on this elliptical trajectory. In this trap, it moves on trajectory which is close to circular. And as ions move, they populate this cylinder, which you see in the middle of the trap. And this is where we have the first step towards mass analyzer, because even though there are three different frequencies of motion, rotation, oscillations in radius and oscillation along the axis, there is one frequency which is completely independent on all initial parameters of ions except mass to charge ratio. And this is the axial frequency. And here we have this ideal Kindon trap, which gives us already frequency dependent only on mass, but there are still some little things left. Like, for example, how could we detect ions effectively? And for this, we split the outer electrodes, outer hyperconical surface, into two symmetrical electrodes and connect them to the input of a differential amplifier. And as ions are rotating around the central electrode and bouncing back and forward, we detect here on the output sinusoidal signal. And what is important is that if you have different ions of different mass to charge ratios, they all oscillate independently. And therefore, they all produce many, many signals overlapped with each other. To deduce those frequencies, we used Fourier transform. We convert this transient into frequency spectrum, and frequencies we could measure very accurately. And therefore, we could get from frequency spectrum simultaneous measurement of all masses. And now, the next key step is how to get ions at the correct energies, correct spot inside the trap. It took a long time, many different attempts, avenues were tried, and in the end, we finished with the electrodynamic squeezing of pulsed packets. So what it means is that somehow we create a packet of ions outside of the trap, and we direct this packet towards the field tangentially to its future trajectory. And as ions enter the field, we apply increased voltage to the central electrode, so that field strength here between central and outer electrode continuously increases. And this forces ions to get inside and starts their oscillations. And as we increase the voltage on the central electrode, radius of ion trajectory gets smaller and smaller. And then we stop this squeezing voltage, and ions stabilize at a particular radius inside the trap. What is important is that we injected a packet of ions, so there may be thousands, hundreds of thousands ions in this packet, and only one frequency, axial frequency, is independent on initial parameters, but rotational frequency is quite dependent. So just after 10 or 100 oscillations, this initial packet will spread into a ring which rotates around the central electrodes and bounces along this central electrode. And this is very important, that all space charge, which initially was concentrated in a small packet, now gets spread over pretty long length. And one part of this ring is shielded from the other part by the central electrode. And this later appeared to be very important for linearity and high space charge capacity of the trap. And now we know how to trap ions, how to detect them, how to inject them. The only thing, how to create this short ion packet at the entrance to the trap. And here we have some kind of obvious answer. Let's try laser source and let's see what happens afterwards. And this is what was done at the end of the 90s. So here you see this self-built machine where old nitrogen laser was hitting stainless steel surface, and then ions were directed through a simple optics into the Orbitrap analyzer. And after some efforts, with the help of our mechanical engineer and electronic engineer, I was able to get this type of spectrum. So finally, we were able to demonstrate that we could indeed get ultra-high resolving power for this source. And we even got a grant from British government, which is like about £45,000, not much, but for a small company, this was a blessing. And this actually allowed us to build this machine. And so we got ultra-high resolution, But this is actually just very, very first proof of principle. We still have a lot of hurdles to overcome on the way to a commercial instrument. So there are many reasons why Orbitrap will never make its way into mainstream mass spectrometry. So first, of course, everything was done for laser source, while in the real mass spectrometry, we usually deal with continuous ion sources. And for continuous ion sources, we don't have solution. And then we quickly found out that tolerance requirements on electrodes were not realistic. And we found that injection and central slot are ruining our resolving power and mass accuracy, that we need very, very high vacuum, and we lose a lot of ions during injection. We cannot inject wide mass range, and so on and so forth. So these were all reasons which were put forward by R&D leaders of major mass spectrometry companies when we tried to sell them this technology. As a small company, of course, we tried every company, and we got quite a nice list, which was good. And from here, we understood that each of those reasons was actually correct, and each of them required a separate project, a separate effort to solve it. For example, just the first reason, injection from continuous ion sources, created a huge effort over many, many years. And this became even more important because by this time, our company was acquired by what is now Thermo Fisher. This was in year 2000. And here you could see our company in an old master's style, and Orbitrap is somewhere in the corner here. And so now, as a part of bigger company, we started to work on what is really most important in order to get instrument to the commercial device, but also we had to carry out all these projects in parallel. And now, if you just look at the needs of pulsed injection into the Orbitrap, we could compare it with the other pulsed or wide mass range mass analyzers. For example, if you look at the typical number of ions which we need to inject each time, we need to inject only a few thousand ions for RF ion trap, but about 1 million into FTICR. For time of flight, each time we inject something like hundreds of ions, which is not that much. For Orbitrap, which uses the same principle of image current detection, we need to inject somewhat similar amount of ions to what we have in FTICR. On the other hand, into normal trapping devices, you could inject ions continuously over hundreds of milliseconds. In time of flights, you need to inject them in pulses which are only a few nanoseconds wide. And in the Orbitrap, because it uses some principles from time of flight, you also need to be pretty fast. Just a few hundreds of nanoseconds is allowed duration of the packet. And also, another complication is that normally mass spectrometers have pretty reasonable apertures through which you could inject ions. It could be several square millimeters for ion traps, hundreds of square millimeters for time of flight, but for the Orbitrap analyzer, where we try to inject into this little trap, the cross-section of injection is actually less than square millimeter. And so if you summarize this, we need to inject a camel load of ions with lightning speed through eye of a needle. And this was quite a challenge. And it took a lot of effort, and new colleagues joined the team who continue to work on Orbitrap product now at a new level. And finally, after many failed attempts, we came to the scheme which allowed us to solve these problems. And this scheme utilizes an external RF storage device. So here we have like quadrupole, and RF is applied to those quadrupole rods. And then we have some background gas there, nitrogen, and ions are injected along the axis of this device. So ions come in, get trapped, and now we quickly ramp down RF voltage on those electrodes and instead apply extraction voltage, which moves ions sideways through a slot in one of the electrodes of the quadrupole. And so ions are forced to leave quadrupole, and then optics is curved in such a way that it converges ions on the entrance to the orbitrap. And once they come here, they actually look as if they came from a laser ion source. And so what happens afterwards is exactly the same as was happening in the first laser source apparatus. And so now we get those ion rings, we detect them, and could make an instrument. And now, with this device, we could interface it to all types of continuous sources on the front. However, for people who deal with quantitation, there is one thing which immediately rings alarm. We have now two traps. We have C-trap here, we have Orbitrap here. So we have two-stage trapping. And trapping and quantitation is usually not coming together pretty well. And this is the one of the biggest dogmas in mass spectrometry. And this is what we decided to sort of challenge. And so if you look at what we need for quantitation, then of course we need high linearity between signal in, signal out, and input. And for this, if you have a trap, you have linear detection system thanks to image current detection. But you need to have really good control over input-dependent effects, which is space charge effects, mass-dependent effects, and so on. And this, of course, is not addressed by this configuration at all. So what we need is all types of control over ion beam and corrections for space charge. Second, we need high discriminating power. So here we have nicely high resolution, but it doesn't mean that we have high mass accuracy, because space charge effects could move masses of ions. And again, potentially it could be solved by controlling the number of ions correctly. Third, we need very high dynamic range. So here we are helped by our central electrode that we have very high ion capacity, but for beams which are sometimes present in mass spectrometry with many orders of magnitude difference in intensities, we don't have a real solution. So it needs to be addressed by some kind of intelligent filling, so that large peaks are getting less charges and small peaks get more charges. And we will see later how it is done. And of course, we need low limits of quantitation. For this, we need high transmission, which was enforced by the scheme which I just showed. And we need high sensitivity of detection. And again, image current detection with modern electronics allows to detect down to few elementary charges in a peak. And therefore, here we are actually pretty good, even though, of course, it required a lot of improvements in electronics. And then we need to be compatible with very fast separations. For life sciences, it is ultra-high performance LC, and for GC community, requirements are even tougher. And here, we need to do a lot of measures. We need to have much faster analyzer. We need to decouple filling of the C-trap from detection, and so on. And so, as you see, there is a long list of things which need to be done before we could get to proper quantitation with this two-trap setup. So we need some help. And this help came from other instruments produced at the time in our company. Two very successful giants which made Orbitrap possible. So there is linear trap as developed in San Jose, and there is combination of linear trap with FTICR instruments, which was at that time developed in Bremen. And so this instrument gives the recipe for Orbitrap. Let's use Orbitrap in the same way as ICR, so that all operations are carried out by the linear trap, and this big FTICR cell on the back is used just by as an accurate mass detector. However, at that time, everybody is aware of Murphy's law. What can go wrong will go wrong. And we still have a lot of things which could go wrong at that time. This is like 2004. So we cannot produce ultra-precision electrodes. We had just one instrument working, and nobody could guarantee that it could be reproduced in series. We have a lot of units which were never produced before. We need to hold central electrode voltage stable, and we need to satisfy very strict vacuum and noise requirements in a very compact package. And so just this first requirement already became multi-year project. If you have tolerances in the Orbitrap anywhere out of a very tight band, then you will get transients which look like this and peaks which have different types of shoulders, bases, and so on, and could be even split. So what we want correct balancing of tolerances, and then our transient will show nice exponential shape, peak will be close to Gaussian, and this would allow to use such instrument in real-life analysis. And this is where our collaborators from Moscow General Physics Institute developed software which allows to model the Orbitrap. And then our colleagues from Vakutek here in Bremen made their best to implement this technology in a proper manufacturing process. And so, in the end, in 2005, we rolled out this combination of the linear trap with the Orbitrap analyzer. And here you could see how it looked like. Ions are produced by this electrospray ion source, transported from atmosphere into vacuum to the linear trap, and then they get stored, and they could be mass analyzed there, mass selected, whatever is happening to them. In the end, ions for further analysis are stored near the exit from the linear trap, and they're held by a small potential hump on this electrode. And then this voltage is released, and ions are allowed to travel to the C-trap. And there, they lose energy in collisions with the background gas and get stored. Then we squeeze them a little bit with voltages, and then we ramp down RF voltage and apply DC voltage to eject them from the C-trap. At the same time, voltage starts to change on the central electrode in the Orbitrap analyzer. And so ions are traveling along this potential relief and enter the field. And then, as we have seen, they get injected, form ion rings, and get detected. What appeared to be very important for the success of this instrument is very high transmission of ions from this point to the spectrum, about 30 to 50%. And this is orders of magnitude higher than other accurate mass analyzers. And this, of course, ensured rapid acceptance of Orbitrap in the field, which is exceptionally sensitive to detection limits and transmission, and this is proteomics. And at the same time, for quantitation, we could see that some of the problems got addressed with the help of AGC provided by the linear trap. Because linear trap cannot operate without tight control of ions, we could use its capabilities to help us with the Orbitrap as well. And this is how the problem was solved for LTQ Orbitrap instrument. However, it was still running at about 3 spectra per second on the Orbitrap side, and we still were not able to play at will with the charges which we inject into the Orbitrap. And therefore, we still have a way to go till we get to proper quantitation. So since then, several generations of instruments appeared. So starting from LTQ Orbitrap, new generation of C-traps, 1, 2, 3, and so on, were introduced. And MALDI ion source, ETD option, Orbitrap-only instrument executive was introduced, S-lens for higher transmission, quadruple-based hybrids with multiple fields, EFTs, and so on. Tribrid MS last year, and here you could see the list of instruments which were introduced and utilized the Orbitrap analyzer. And here you could see the analytical performance of the system. This is, in the center, is performance of the original LTQ Orbitrap. And since then, sensitivity increased by more than order of magnitude, resolving power in 1 second acquisitions quadrupled, and the sensitivity of image current detection increased a lot. Number of MSMS per second increased several times, and number of fragmentation techniques also grew quite considerably. So there was a great progress, and now Orbitrap mass spectrometry developed into a powerful tree where the trunk is Orbitrap analyzer, and on its crown we have three different families of instruments. We still have LTQ Orbitrap family, where the top tier is Orbitrap Elite. And then we have routine instruments of executive series without quadrupole or with quadrupole. And on the top, we have the our all singing, all dancing tribrid Orbitrap Fusion. And so today I will quickly go through all three families to show you the flair of what they're capable of and how it could be applied for other areas. So for example, the top and end of the line for LTQ Orbitrap instruments became Orbitrap Elite. Comparing to the first instruments, we had this special RF lens interface, which allowed to increase sensitivity by order of magnitude. We have now not single linear trap, but dual trap, which goes up to 12 scans per second, and freedom of fragmentation with three different methods for fragmentation. So they're important for proteomics, but probably only one of them could be used for other applications. And on the Orbitrap side, we have compact high-field Orbitrap, which is significantly smaller than the previous one. And we have special signal processing technique, which allows us to double resolving power of the Orbitrap. And this, on that instrument, allowed us to get 240,000 resolving power in about 760 milliseconds, and also increased scan speed. And so currently, this instrument is used for special applications, like, for example, here. This is just to show a record, but it also shows what technology is capable of. So we were able to get more than 1 million resolving power, of course, for relatively small masses. But for those masses, if you look at the smallest isotopes, you could see that we are able to fully separate the isobaric isotopes. And from this, we could actually do isotope counting. We could count how many C13s, N15s, O18s we have in this particular molecule. And this is probably where this high resolving power might find use in future. But of course, the real workhorse for Orbitrap mass spectrometry is now a co-executive instrument. So this instrument brings ultra-high resolution on the benchtop, and its layout is different from the original LTQ Orbitrap. So here, again, we have electrospray source. We have RF lens in order to focus expanding ions at high pressures and bring them down to the instrument. And then we have quadrupole mass filter. And now we have C-trap with additional collision cell. And here we have capability of filling the C-trap independently of detecting in the Orbitrap. And also, we could switch during this filling this quadrupole mass filter and get different ions to come into the C-trap. And also, fragmentation takes place almost at the same time frame as trapping here. So by fragmenting ions, you don't need to spend any more than a few milliseconds extra. And then Orbitrap analyzer with this EFT processing allows to give up to 12 scans per second. So this is, of course, faster than it was before, but still only approaching the usability, for example, for GC. So these are parameters which you could get at different speeds on this instrument. At 1.5 hertz, it gives 140,000 resolution, and at 12 hertz, it gives 17,500 resolution. And of course, spectra are pretty much the same. And mass accuracy is in low ppm range, as you could see here. So this is with external calibration. And also important here is that we try to use external calibration, and this required a lot of thermal stabilization to be developed and so on. And you could see how it changes over many, many hours. So this 2.5 days. And here you could see cycling of the air conditioner in the room. So it was jumping by several degrees. And nevertheless, the mass was still staying within a few ppm. And of course, with internal calibration, all these deviations could be taken off. And another interesting capability of this instrument is that still using external calibration, you could switch from positive polarity to negative polarity, and you still stay within 1 ppm error. So here you could see that each time we switch, red point is one polarity, blue point another, and it's all done within 1 second. And here you could see how parallelization increases the speed of analysis. So while Orbitrap is acquiring previous injection, we start to feel the C-trap. As soon as acquisition ends in the Orbitrap, we inject ions into the analyzer, acquisition starts, and we are ready to inject into the C-trap next population, and so on. And if you look even for lowest resolving power, when we acquire at the fastest rate of Orbitrap, we could feel C-trap up to 50 milliseconds each time and still not affect acquisition rate of the instrument. It still would run at 12.5 hertz. And only if you need to feel for longer time do we start to lose the acquisition rate of the instrument. And for high resolving powers, duty cycle could be more than 90%. So it means that in this case, up to 65% of your entire chromatography could be used for filling trap with ions and high efficiency detection. And this, of course, typical method, how it is run in LCMS. So we have full MS spectrum, and then from there we detect, we select data-dependent scans. We select precursors which needs to be fragmented and for which MSMS needs to be acquired. So filling could start already while this scan is still running. And this allows to have up to 10 MSMS spectra together with full MS in 1 second. And for proteomics, it basically allowed us to get more proteins detected from 20 nanograms than other instruments detect from 5 micrograms. And for more complicated cells, we were able to break 3,000 proteins per hour barrier, which since then was further improved to more than 4,000 proteins per hour. But if we now come to the more practical situation, when we are trying to do targeted analysis of low-level analytes, this is where we need to have a little bit more elaborate strategy of using the space charge of the Orbitrap. And this is where so-called intelligent filling takes place. So if you look, for example, at this spectrum, this very simple spectrum, and if we are interested just in a single peak here, but we still store all ions here, we will see quite interesting effect. So for this peak of interest, we'll get storage time of only quarter of millisecond, and for peak of interest, we'll get a signal-to-noise ratio of about 750. Now, if we just concentrate on the peak of interest with relatively wide window, like 10 AMU, for the same number of ions total, we'll have a little bit longer field time, but we'll get signal-to-noise about 7 times higher. And this is surprisingly just for very simple mixture. When complex mixture appears, the gain could be tens and hundreds. And usually with high resolution, it is sufficient to have a SIM scan of this ion in order to identify it. However, if there is strong matrix, then MSMS comes to help. So here, I would like to show how resolving power helps. So here we have two isobaric, pesticides, which are at 1 to 3 mixed together. And at resolution 15,000, we just see a peak which doesn't correspond to any of them. So we have false identification here. As we go forward with 35,000, small peak starts to separate. With 50,000, they are already pretty well separated. And with 100,000, they're baseline separated. And we are able to determine elemental composition for each of them. And it means that each of them we could identify and quantify just in full mass scan. Here, with the testosterone in serum, we have much more complicated situation because it actually comes with a lot of matrix. So when we look at very narrow mass window, we still are able to see the peak of testosterone at low concentration, but with the signal-to-noise, it's actually not sufficient. We could get linear curve, but in order to be completely sure, we need also to fragment it and to do the same curve, the same line for its fragments. And this actually is done on two fragments, 97 and 109. And this allows to quantitate and confirm testosterone, both on parent and fragments, down to very low concentrations. And now another step in this development is to fill the C-trap not with single SIM window, but for example, with multiple SIM window. In this case, again, Orbitrap is still running its previous acquisition, and we start to fill C-trap from one population. So quadrupole is set to one mass, then to another mass, to third mass, to fourth, and so on, up to 10 masses. And we could store ions in the C-trap for a very long time, up to many seconds, nothing changes there. So it means that we could mix them together, and then when we inject them into the Orbitrap analyzer, we get all these windows detected in parallel, and we could basically quantify each of them. And this way, we are decoupling speed of LC or GC separation from the speed of detection. And one important feature of this hybrid is actually sensitivity for quantitation when you go to high and high numbers of fragments. Here you could see comparison of, on this line, we have just simple experiment when we have a precursor which split into n fragments of equal intensity, and we quantify on the sum of those fragment intensities. And then we compare three instruments with identical front end. So we have the same source, the same mass filter to select the same collision cell, and only the back end is different. In one case, blue line, we have quadrupole, red line, we have Orbitrap, and green line, we have time of flight. And now, if we request that variation of the sum of intensities of these fragments should stay below the level of 10%, then here we could see how many ions do we need on the front of the instrument in order to get correct quantitation for large and larger number of transitions. And we could see that when we have just one transition, one precursor gives one fragment and nothing more, then triple quadrupole requires less ions than any other hybrid. However, when we have, for example, five fragments for triple quadrupole, we need to jump between five fragments, still keeping on the same precursor. So we need five times more ions. While for Orbitrap, because we detect all fragments in parallel, the number of ions required grew only slightly because of noise. And for time of flight, because of low transmission, we need like almost like five, seven times more ions. And as we increase the number of transitions required, Orbitrap becomes more and more sensitive relatively to the triple quadrupoles. And this even without utilizing very high resolving power, mass accuracy, and so on. So this is just on pure statistics for peaks without any chemical interference. And so this actually shows potential for Orbitrap quantitation when we go towards complicated targets, like for example, peptide quantitation. So for peptide, you need from three to six fragments. And this is where coexecutive becomes more sensitive than triple quadrupole. And this is what we see now in proteomics, the shift from triple quad quantitation to Orbitrap quantitation. And here, if you combine this multiplexed SIM method and compare it to the same SRM method for the same precursors on high-end triple, we could see that when we have a lot of ions, when you don't need much time to acquire sufficient population, they give a similar number of quantified peptides. However, as we go down with the amount, Orbitrap quantitation becomes more and more advantageous over triple quad quantitation because of this effect which I just have shown. And so finally, as we come back to this table of what we need for quantitation, we could see that a new generation of the instruments allows to address also ultra-fast acquisitions, which for LC are 1 to 2 seconds, and for GC, most likely we have to use technology which you have seen from the Orbitrap Elite, the compact Orbitrap analyzer. And with this intelligent filling and decoupling of filling from detection, we are able to finally come to the time of quantitation with the Orbitrap analyzer. And just in conclusion, I wanted to mention our top-tier platform, Orbitrap Fusion, simply because it also has some technologies which will later penetrate to the low and lower tiers. So in this instrument, we have new world and mass spectrometry. We have three analyzers, Orbitrap, Quadrupole, and Lineatrap, all combined in one instrument. And the new world is tri-built. So tri-built means three analyzers, and I could talk for hours about how it works in proteomics and so on, but one of the things which it has is combination of all these three analyzers. And for quadrupole mass filter, we have top of the range quadrupole with high mass range capabilities. We have very fast dual pressure linear ion trap, which now allows more than 20 hertz MSMS. And for Orbitrap, we are able to go from 50,000 at 15 hertz, which later will become 20 hertz, to about 500,000 for 1 second duration of the acquisition. So this shows that Orbitrap is expanding in both directions, both in speed and the ultimate resolving power. And what it allows for sort of routine analysis in future, in this particular case, it has built-in internal calibration. And with internal calibration, you could see chromatographic peaks for different small molecules. And you could see that across the entire chromatographic peak, we are staying with sub-ppm accuracy. And now here we have something else, some other peaks. So if you zoom on them, they're also followed through the entire peak with the sub-ppm mass accuracy. And so this is the future for applying this technology in for fast separations, that we should be able to stay on the peak with very narrow window, and this allows to differentiate our peak from all matrices. And so finally, Orbitrap mass spectrometry has come a long way since inception, and it continues to develop. So we started to look at biological systems with pretty low detail. And then ultra-high resolution and MSMS sensitivity gave detail to this picture and also color. And now higher throughput and quantitation capabilities allow us to see biological systems in dynamics. And further progress will be based on increasingly intelligent utilization of the C-trap and Orbitrap capabilities, for example, with spectral multiplexing. And the next talk by Amelia Peterson will present how Orbitrap could be used in other areas, like in this case, gas chromatography. So I tried not to go there, just to leave all space for you. And meanwhile, I would like to remind you that even though I'm presenting this, but there is a huge team on the both sides of Atlantic behind this instrument, which involves a lot of people from R&D, marketing, and management, as you could see here in Bremen and in San Jose. And thank you very much for your attention.